This is the video lecture on accounting for merchandise operations. Up until this point, we've had various companies that we've dealt with in our examples and as well in our homework assignments. But all these companies, as different as they are, they actually have one thing in common. And what they have in common is they've all been service companies. And a service company is a company that brings in revenue by actually providing a service. So in this lecture, we're actually going to start to talk about a new type of company, and this is a merchandising company. And a merchandising company actually brings in revenue by selling a product rather than a service. And there are going to be certain differences when dealing with a merchandising company as compared to a service company. There are going to be certain things that we've done in the past that will have to be changed, and there will also be some new journal entries that we've never recorded before. Now, the first way in which a merchandising company is different has to do with profit. And it's always very important that we have the ability to calculate profit. And in a merchandising company, that calculation is a little bit more complicated. One way that it's going to be different has to do with revenue. We're still going to have revenue, but it'll actually have a new title. And the new title that we're going to use is sales. So you'll start to see sales utilized in a lot of journal entries, and you'll even see sales on a lot of financial statements and even on the chart of accounts. And it's always a very good sign when you see sales, you automatically know that you're dealing with a merchandise company. If you don't see sales, you know that it's actually a service company. And also, in merchandising companies, they tend to calculate profit on the actual product before the final profit. So if you look at this equation, this is a profit equation that we've been utilizing in previous lectures, and this works for a service company. It's a very simple profit formula. You start off with revenue minus expense, and as we've said before, if you have a positive answer, that's a net income, they made money, or if you have a negative answer, that is a net loss. But in a merchandising company, that old profit formula that we've been using will be a little bit different. It'll be set up in a two-part formula. The first part, we start off with net sales, and remember, that's the revenue for a merchandising company, and then we deduct the cost of goods sold. And the cost of goods sold represents the cost of the product. And when we deduct that, we get the gross profit. Now, the gross profit is simply the profit that we made on selling the actual product itself. It's not the final answer, because to get the final answer for profit, we would have to take that gross profit and then deduct all the various expenses. And then finally, we would have either the net income or the net loss. So it's a slightly more expanded and slightly more complex way of calculating profit, simply because we're dealing with a merchandising company rather than a service company. Another way that merchandising companies are different is they have a new asset account. And the new asset account is inventory. And sometimes certain companies will go by inventory. Sometimes they use a different title, which would be merchandise inventory. But either way, this is the inventory of our product. And this is the product that we're going to be purchasing and selling. So we have to have an asset account set up in order to record all the changes in inventory. Now, before we can actually start to sell our product, first we have to purchase the product. And when we buy this product, there are going to be different transactions that can occur. And of course, we're going to record a journal entry for each one of these transactions. When we buy merchandise, there's always a possibility of us receiving a discount. And the reason that the vendors that we buy from offer these discounts is to encourage fast payment. These vendors want to receive the payment as quickly as possible. So they will offer that discount in order to encourage us to pay quickly. And the discount terms are always going to be listed on the invoice of every purchase that we make. Now, if these discount terms are going to be listed, we need to talk about the format. They are going to be quoted to us in a very specific format. There's a four-part process. The very first number, that represents the percent of possible discount. So it could be 1%, 2%, 5%. It really just depends on what the company has decided to offer. But the key word there is possible. It's a possible discount. There's no guarantee that we will receive that discount. And whether or not we receive it depends on the next item. The second number, this is the number of days in the discount period. So in other words, we have a window of opportunity to potentially receive that discount. And if we want to get that discount, we're going to have to pay within that number of days. The third item is the letter N. And N always represents net or full price. And then the final number represents the total number of days by which the bill must be paid. So those are the four components of discount terms. So to take a look at an example, this is a pretty typical example of discount terms that a lot of companies would offer. And it says 210 and 30. So the way we would interpret that is based on those four components that we just talked about. So the first number, the number 2 in this case, means that we could potentially receive a 2% discount. But in order to receive that discount, we would have to pay this bill within 10 days. So that's the window of opportunity. If we fail to pay within 10 days, we would have to pay net or full price, and we would have a period of 30 days in which to do that. So that would be our discount possibility. And you can see the way this works. It's designed as a motivator. They're trying to motivate us to pay and to pay quickly because they would prefer to get that money as soon as possible. Now, to take a look at an actual example of a purchase, this first purchase is going to be a cash purchase. And these are always the most straightforward because with cash purchases, it means that we're going to go ahead and pay in advance and we don't even have to worry about the credit terms. So in this example, this company will purchase $2,000 worth of merchandise and they're going to go ahead and pay with cash. And a journal entry is definitely required for this transaction. So the journal entry is a debit to merchandise inventory and a credit to cash. And when you see a journal entry like this, both of these titles are actually assets. Merchandise inventory is an asset as well as cash. So what we're saying here is I debit merchandise inventory, which increases the value of my inventory by $2,000, and I credit cash, which decreases that asset. So it shows that I am spending that money. I'm spending $2,000. Now another option, if I don't want to pay for it up front, I could also have a credit purchase. So this is pretty much the exact same example. It is a $2,000 purchase, but the difference here is that we've decided to charge this purchase. So since we're charging, we actually need to know the credit terms. And the credit terms that are being offered are the exact same credit terms that we talked about before. A possible 2% discount if paid within 10 days, otherwise full payment is due within 30 days. The other thing that becomes important is also the date. The date is December 1st. Now, many of the transactions that we've covered have had a date, but to be honest with you, in the past, the date was not particularly important. We would always make a notation of the date, but it didn't really have a big effect on the accounting. But in a transaction like this, the date does matter because that window of opportunity actually begins on December the 1st. So that means that if I want to take advantage of this discount, I'm going to have to pay for this on or before the 11th. Now, when you look at the journal entry, it's almost exactly like the previous example. In fact, the only difference is this part of the journal entry right here. Rather than credit cash, I'm going to credit accounts payable because I'm charging this particular purchase. I'm going to have to pay for this at a later date. So I want to use a liability rather than cash. Now, to take a look at the subsequent journal entry, there are actually two different versions, two different possibilities. One possibility is if I make the payment on or before December 11th, then that means I'm going to be entitled to the discount. So I can debit accounts payable $2,000. I'm going to pay for this with cash, so I'll credit cash. But notice that I do not have to pay the full $2,000. I'm actually going to pay less than that because I do receive the discount. So that number of $1,980, that represents the discounted price. And the way to get that number is think about the percentage involved. If I'm getting a 2% discount, that means I'm going to pay 98% of the price. So I can multiply the $2,000 by 0.98 and get $1,980. That is 98% of the price. But now I have a little bit of a problem. I've debited AP for $2,000. I've credited cash for $1,980. That doesn't balance. So to make this journal entry balance, I need another $20 on the credit side. So that's going to go as a credit to merchandise inventory. Now, why does that go to merchandise inventory? Well, think about it. That's going to lower the value. It's not going to be worth $2,000. The inventory actually cost me $1,980. So I want to lower that by $20. Remember, we want our assets to reflect the actual cost. So that's one possibility. Now, the other possibility is that if I fail to make the payment until after December 11th, then I'm not going to receive the discount. So in that case, I debit accounts payable $2,000 and I have to pay the full price. So I credit cash for $2,000. That would be if I missed the discount opportunity. And there are lots of reasons why we would sometimes miss that opportunity, and we're going to talk about some of those in a future lecture.